sits alone by the back door, trying to find the word that's escaped her mind. She says, God's the one I love the most, but religion's left me behind. They never let her in, only say how much she sinned, and she thinks she's too far gone. I say that I don't care, I just point my hands to your altar there, and I pray to God you gotta help her find her way. I say let her come, when her tears fall down like rain, let her sing. Holy praises to your name, let her pray. Let her reach right out to you, and as her heart fills up with your love, let her heal, let her heal. This morning he woke up alone, found a Bible sitting by his phone. He said, maybe, maybe I'll get saved someday. He wanted to pray with you. He walked in and no one said a word to him. So he walked back out and felt left out and felt sorry for himself. I say, let him come. When his tears fall down like rain, let him sing. Holy praises to your name, let him pray. Let him reach right out to you, and as his heart fills up with your love, let him heal, let him heal. I say, let him come. When the tears fall down like rain, let him sing. Holy praises to your name, let him pray. Let him reach right out to you, and as their hearts fill up with your love, let him heal, let him heal. He died for you and me, now we need to help others see. He died for them too, and wants them to come home. The church raised the bar too high, while the lost lose their hope and die. I'm like, oh my Lord, please help us. Won't you guide our hands to just let them come. The tears fall down like rain, let them sing. Holy praises to your name, let them pray. Let them reach right out to you, and as their hearts fill up with your love, let them heal, let them heal. I say let them come. When the tears fall down like rain, let them sing. Holy praises to your name, let them come. Let them reach right out to you, and as their hearts fill up with your love, let them heal. Lord, let them heal.
got your Bibles, you can go and turn with me to Ezekiel chapter 37. Ezekiel chapter 37, I'm going to start around verse 11. Let me lay a foundation before we get going here. I'm not a quitter. I've never quit nothing I've ever done in my life. Been hard to get there sometimes, guys, and I'm sure you guys have been through it, most of you. Anybody can quit. I was raised by a U.S. Marine, and my precious mom's here tonight again. And Elmer, thank you for being here with her. Love you, buddy. And my dad died, went on to heaven, but I was raised by a U.S. Marine, and the kids always ask me, is there anything you're scared of? Not a thing. And that don't make me a bad man. It just, my daddy didn't raise us to be afraid of stuff. Why would you ever raise your kids to be afraid of stuff? Because you put them in a shell from such an early age. It don't mean you're a tough guy. But you're just not afraid of stuff. So you've enjoyed life a whole lot better. And of course, in my lifetime, it kind of took me on the wrong trail because I wasn't afraid to try anything neither. But that's a whole other problem. But my dad raised me without being afraid of stuff. But the church, for some strange reason, and I like I said, I say this all the time. I got a TV show. You all know that. I say it on there. I can't wait till it goes international and national. Because the church is petrified. We're afraid. We're afraid of offending somebody. We're afraid of getting in trouble with the law. We're afraid of this, afraid of the devil. We're afraid of everything. We don't even want to fight a good fight of faith because we're afraid if we try to fight, the enemy will get worse. But I'm here to tell you, he didn't call us and he did not give us a spirit of fear. But the title of his sermon tonight is Rise Up, Children. And I'm going to start reading Ezekiel 37, verse 11. Praise God. Well, if I could, this Bible is not listed 1, 2, 3 straight down. You got to backtrack all through the verse to find it. Then he said to me, and I'm reading from the NLT tonight. Then he said to me, son of man, these bones represent the people of Israel. They are saying, we have become old, dry bones. All hope is gone. Our nation is finished. Verse 12, therefore prophesy to them and say, this is what the sovereign Lord says, O my people, I will open your graves of exile and cause you to rise again. Then I will bring you back to the land of Israel. When this happens, oh my people, you will know that I am the Lord. Hallelujah. Let me go and read the 14. I will put my spirit in you. Wow. And you will live again and return home to your own land. Then you will know that I am the Lord, have spoken, and I have done what I said. Yes, the Lord has spoken. Now you go back around verse 1 of the same chapter. Go up there and cut that Tim's monitor off. You go verse 1, the Spirit of the Lord carries the prophet in a vision, and he sees a valley of dry bones. Can you imagine looking out at hundreds of thousands of skeletons scattered off? It'd be kind of rough to look at, probably. And they was very dry because they'd been scattered. They'd been laying there for a long, long time. But then God spoke to the man of God. He said, in the King James Version, it says, prophesy. Well, first he asked some questions. Can these bones live? And the man, son of God, the man told God, he said, only you know it, Lord. But then he said, I want you to prophesy over this valley of dry bones. And the word prophesied there is literally preach life back to these bones. And he began to prophesy and preach. And he began to see a shaking going on. And these bones, and they come in and took a skeleton form instead of bones laying around. But then it continued to shake, and the body parts begin to go in, and the muscles and the sinews holding the knees and the elbows and putting everything back together come again. And then the skin growed all over it, but yet they just laid there. And then God told the man, he said, prophesy, O son of man, unto the four winds and let them breathe. And he began to prophesy unto the four winds, and the Bible said they begin to blow. And these, what once was a valley of dry bones scattered apart, rose up a living destiny and a deity. Now let me explain this to you. That's a prophetic word to the children of Israel that had been scattered all apart and tore apart. But if you look across the right side of our water boundaries, you see a country that's back together. But let me tell you, spiritually, oh, I want to use this as a church, because I'm going to pull some other scriptures in here. The church has a form and a fashion for so long. We have our three or four songs, and the preachers are governed by deacons, and the deacons are governed by mad women that want to get back home. The husbands, the reason they're mad because the husbands didn't come. Boy, I got your attention now, didn't I? And so, we have a form and a fashion, and then Sunday mornings, don't you dare go past 12. You know why I don't like having Sunday mornings? I don't get to preaching about 12:30. I used to evangelize, and I've had more pastors. Brother Mike, we like to get out about a quarter to 12. I said, that won't happen today. Especially my other bands with me. We like to sing. You know, we's one of them old Pentecostal rooted bands. We want to sing all day, you know. Amen. But the church is intimidated. It's been engulfed into believing if we're not offensive to somebody, oh my God. If we're just gentle little tiny Tims, tiptoe around and don't sing nothing aggressive, don't read the hard part of the Bible, leave out repent, blood, cross, leave out salvation, hell, leave out, Mary had a little lamb, we can talk about that. But we have a form and a fashion. Some denominations, I don't care which building you go in, they're preaching a sermon that was emailed to them. I knew a new word. Emailed to them to preach. I like to meet them guys. That guy must be closer to God. Anybody that makes the sermon knows that's what everybody needs. I believe the pastor needs to get on his knees and stay there until he gets him a real anointing and gets him a message from God for his congregation, what I believe. Because with everybody's different. I was sharing with somebody earlier before the service started. I pictured Jesus and the boys walking around. How many have seen the movie Tombstone? The good one, you know. When he says, you tell him I'm coming, all hell's coming with me. You know, the good one. I know a lot of Christians won't raise their hand. I never seen no movie. Had a dirty word in. I'm a good Christian, bless God. But you watch HBO, it burns your TV tubes out. But let me tell you something. That's how I pictured Jesus coming into town. All hell was with him. Walking into town, I'm going to take it back. And see, but the church has been this so gentle little thing. And we've lost battles and lost battles because we don't realize we are soldiers of the cross. But then when looking at a valley of dry bones, when it represents a church that's dry, that's dying, and he tells the men of God all over the country, begin to pray and preach these valley of dry bones. And see, God's wanting to get you out of your comfort zone. He wants you to quit doing what you've been doing and doing what he wants you to do.
He wants you to spend a little time with him. He wants you to find a place to get on your knees for a while. He wants you to push back a plate for a little bit. He wants you to get in the Bible and read a little bit. He wants you to truly learn to love one another and love those out there, regardless what shape they are in. He wants us to be a whole lot more like Jesus Christ instead of Tom and Jerry on the cartoon hour. Come on.
Well, let me lay down if I can get away from my sermon. I do that a lot. And I got another new sermon to preach later. But the dry bones, they are spiritually dead. And as a church, we are spiritually dead across the land. And you know how to fix it. I'm going to use a word. I say it some, but it's not a very popular word in church no more. But we need to repent. I'm not talking about getting saved. I'm talking about the church needs to repent and turn. Listen to this. I'm going to say it a little bit different, brother. Turn from the religious spirits that we've been walking around in. We need to get out of the dryness. Because when Jesus left the scene, he said, listen, I'm not going to leave you comfortless. I'm going to send the Comforter. And after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, ye shall receive power. But hold on here. Power for what? To carry out the Great Commission and do his will. Not have church as somebody told you to have church, but read the scriptures to see how we're supposed to be having church. Amen. Amen. But repent and turn back to God. I ask so many people every week, we'll talk, you're that biker preacher. Well, I'm just a preacher. I don't know about being a biker preacher, but I'm a preacher. And everywhere we go, people want to talk about it. And I ask them, are you saved? Well, I go to this church. I don't care what church you go to. Are you saved? Well, I'm Baptist. I don't care if you're Baptist. Are you? I don't care about that. Are you saved? Well, I go to my granddaddy's church. I've been down there for 61 years. Have you gotten saved yet? Come on. We are religious people in a valley of dry bones, and we dare anybody to come in and shake our little home up. Now the mission of Trash Ministry. We was born to raise hell, R-A-Z-E, to tear it up, turn it over, and explode it. Amen. Then he can pour himself out upon and in you. But you've got to be a willing vessel. How many ever seen the movie Rudy? Y'all remember that movie? I love that movie. That thing come out years ago. Rudy played for Notre Dame. He's a walk-on. And he practiced and practiced and practiced and worked and worked. And his last year, the seniors come in and said they weren't going to play. They kept putting his jerseys down on Dan Devine's desk. True story. But Rudy would take a beating in practice, and he'd get up and go again. He kept pressing on. And finally, the last game, they won't just run the clock out. And one of the running backs or receivers told the quarterback, dude, if you don't throw a touchdown, Rudy ain't going to get on here. He don't play offense. Dan Devine called some play. Well, they called something else, some little trick play, and got a touchdown. Dan Devine was upset about it. And then the kickoff, and everybody's, Rudy, Rudy. And so what happened? Finally, the guy put him on the kickoff coverage team. And he went down, a little bitty guy, went down, got part of the tackle, and he was running back and forth. He was, and the coach said, just stay out there. And he sacked the quarterback, and they carried him off the field. Now, the story I'm trying to relay to you, this guy put the time in to be able to get put into the ball game.
See, some people want to be in church to be the singer or be the preacher, but they don't want to put the time in and count the cost to be equipped to do what needs to be done. It's not easy leading people. It's not easy preaching the truth. It's not easy singing because you got people pulling you from all directions. But if you repent and turn back to God, and my Bible says, my sheep know my voice, and the strangers they will not follow. Well, now let me go to Ephesians chapter 5. I ain't going to get this sermon out, I don't guess. Tell them to slow down on cooking them hot dogs. Man, I done went the wrong direction. Hang on here, boys. I got a brand new Bible. Come on, right there. Ephesians 5. Ephesians 5. One more page. Start verse 13, I think. Y'all can see it better than I can. Ephesians 5 and verse 13, listen to this. But their evil intentions will be exposed when the light shines on them. For the light makes everything visible. This is why it said, awake, O sleeper, rise up from the dead, and Christ will give you light. Now listen to this, guys. I want you to understand a couple of things, and then I'm going to preach a little bit. We are not children of the darkness by design, but because of sin. If you go back to Genesis chapter 1, and I'm going to read this. It said, and God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish, over that, everything. But then it goes on, it talks about after he created, he tells Adam to go replenish. The King James uses the word replenish. But as a church, listen to this. He told Adam to be fruitful. But to be fruitful as a church, the word of God's got to grow in you, and you've got to grow in your relationship with God. Because being fruitful, when he told Adam to be fruitful, he was telling Adam literally this, guys. Listen to this. You may have never heard it this way, but it's the truth. He was telling Adam, you've got to stay in a relationship with me. And then when the children come on, you've got to teach them about my great love and raise them in my standard. Then the grandchildren, and then they would teach, and then that one would teach, then that one would teach. But the church don't do it because 90% of the church can't tell you what thus saith the Lord is. I'm not trying to be mean. I'm trying to wake you up because I'm nobody special. I'm a servant. That's all I am. But the promises of this book is for every single one of you. But you've got to learn to be fruitful first. Why fruitful? Because if you're not working on your relationship with God and you're not sharing what you've getting out of that relationship, then nothing else matters. And nothing else matters. Because listen, when he said the three promises was to be fruitful, multiply, and dominion. But to multiply in the physical sense is having a family. But in the spiritual sense, to be fruitful, the Bible teaches us that our fruit should remain. Our work should remain. If I fall over dead tonight, some of you might clap, but that's all right. But let me tell you something. This ministry should remain because it's a work of God. It's not Mike Price's thing. How many of you was here a few years ago when I was still wanting to go to Myrtle Beach and quit? God said, he ain't going nowhere just yet. I said, oh, yeah, I am. Well, I'm still here, so he won. But the relationship, the church has to work on our relationship with God. We've got a form and a fashion. We deny the power thereof, and people come in here, y'all kind of loud. We ain't got cranked up yet, boys. I've been down to... Boy, I'm going to say this, and she's going to kill me. I'm probably have a black eye over here when she hits me. I've been down to Suck, Bang, and Blow in Myrtle Beach. It's loud in that place. They got that burnout pit, and them bikes are going all the town and stuff. It's loud. Why can't the church get loud for a little bit? Why don't we lift up our voice and let the world know who we are instead of being ashamed? I'm a Christian. No, I'm blood bought. I'm blood purchased. I belong to Jesus. I'm not going to back up. I'm not going to back down. I'm not going to hell because I'm headed to a place that I'm going to wear a crown of life because Jesus said I can. But then, to multiply in the family, the physical sense, well, we know what that is, all the rugrats. Nothing gets rugrats. Some of them say, what's a rugrat? He called me a rugrat. Yes, I did. Rugrats. See, the church really needs to be rugrats. That means your face is buried in the carpet talking to God more often than not. Hallelujah. But to multiply as a church is leading people to Jesus. Multiplying this church, been out in the highways, in the hedges. All of us go to the beach together. We're apt to talk about the Bible at any time. Amen. Well, that too. April, coming, it's coming. But here's what I'm telling you. As Christians, we should be multiplying our testimony to people that's hurting, people that's lost, people don't look like us, people less fortunate than us. We need to be the eyes, the arms, the mouth, the legs of Jesus Christ. We need to spread a message of hope, of salvation unto the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and saying, He bled and died for you. All you got to do is believe in what He done. He'll save you and forgive you of your sins. Multiplying. I ask pastors all the time, they talk about trash. I come by that other night. Y'all had a lot of people there. All them people Christians? I hope not. Why? I like to have a whole bunch of sinners in here so we can see them get saved. Sinners. Yeah, you know, sinners and guys that does all that bad stuff. All that stuff that we used to do. I never done that. You may not have, but you sure telling a lie right now anyway. I can't get over people say they was good sinners. I've been preaching for almost 20 years. I guess 20 years now, ain't it, Mom? Somewhere around there. They was good sinners. What fun was that? We was good, bad sinners. Just be truthful. We was good, bad sinners. We needed a Savior. But even you ones that think you was a good sinner, you needed Jesus. But dominion, here I want to preach this a little bit. Dominion. You know, He gave dominion over the fish and all that stuff. We'll talk about fishing later. But dominion is not necessarily to rule over. I can't see my scribbling. I even highlighted it. Not only to rule, but more so to take care of. Y'all got to listen to this for a little bit. One, we need to tend to our own garden first. You need to know what's springing up in your garden. Some people tell me, you can't judge me. Well, the Bible don't trick to say that completely. He says we'll be known by our fruit. I've seen a lot of people, they've been attacked by fruit flies. And some of you sitting here. Y'all got my back, right? I got these big guys up front for a reason. They can come in real quick. I got a terrible vision right now. Help me, Lord. I ain't going there. But we supposed to be tending our garden, but we also supposed to help your brothers and sister get their garden right. Now listen to this. I want you to get this crystal clear. I do not care who comes in here. Every Anybody is welcome. I don't care what kind of lifestyle, if you like it or not, they are all welcome. I don't like the sin in my own life. I won't like their sin. But we are going to love the sinner so we can lead them to Jesus and help get them a good garden to grow up in. So, the valley of dry bones. Prophesy, son of man, that the winds would blow. And the wind blew, and they stood up. I believe God is telling the church and his ministers to preach life back into the dead and dying church, and prophetic word on top of them to stand up and rise up and begin to be the body of Christ that we're supposed to be, and reach out to a lost and dying world that needs some garden caretakers removing bad soil and put some good soil and watch them grow up to be the children of God Almighty. Can somebody give him some praise and glory? Because when we do that, if you don't get nothing else out of this sermon, because when we do that, we're truly showing our love, not to them, but for Jesus. Are you listening to me? Because, see, the world, they know they're screwed up. I just got to get the church to realize we're screwed up and get it right in here first. Amen, walls, I'll preach on. Because all of us come short of the glory of God. That's what the Bible says. So quit hiding the fact that we got failures. I get told that all the time. Well, preacher, I heard you on TV and you said you just screwed up. He didn't say screw up. He wouldn't even say that word. I can't believe you even used that word. I said, what word? You know when you say you mess up, I said, screwed up? He said, yeah, that one. Really? Reminds me of a story of John Hagee told one time. John Hagee was talking about this woman went into a church, and it was real prim and proper and deathly quiet. They sung a song, and the woman yelled out, amen, praise the Lord. And the preacher had a little button. He said, y'all keep an eye on her. Well, she done it again, so he pushed the button, told the deacon, go back there, or the usher, go back there and ask her to be quiet. We don't do that kind of stuff in here. So he told her. Well, then the preacher got up there, and she didn't say nothing for a while, but then he finally did say something according to the Bible. She yelled out, praise the Lord, amen, thank God for his word. The preacher hit that button. That guy said, ma'am, if you do it one more time, we're going to escort you out of here. And so the preacher said something else, and, you know, she said, amen, praise the Lord, and the usher's coming and grabbed her. And they was walking out of the church, and going by the front of the church, she started just worshiping God and shouting. And the preacher said, ma'am, why are you rejoicing as we're throwing you out of here? She said, well, you were just reading where Jesus come into town on ass, and I'm just getting thrown out of town by some. Amen, walls. I've been there. But we should be that light. We should have enough gall in us, not being ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because, see, when Jesus died on Calvary, not only did he die for our sins, think about this, he also died that we would be free people in Christ. Think about this. It's one thing to be forgiven. It's another thing to be in bondage to what you've done. But because he eradicated sin when you accepted him, he nailed it on the cross, and he shed his blood for us. He forgave us, but he set us free that we have no guilt, we have no shame, we have no past, so we have all rights to every promise in this book, because we're no longer a bunch of wondering children, but we're children of a living God, and every promise in this book is ours.
There's people outside of these walls that are looking and waiting to hear from you. They're waiting for their neighbor to get off his high horse or her high horse and look across the street and go witness to them. I've said this for ever since I've been preaching. It's one of the first reality checks God taught me. People, I've often wondered why people have been in a church so long and their family never comes. Well, I've invited them. I don't believe that. You may say you have, but here's the reality. They really know the way you live. They know the way you live. They feel no conviction because that's how you live. I ain't saying we're perfect. I done covered that. But if you're willfully living the way the world's living, what'd you get saved from? If you hate, you prejudice, you just hate people, what'd you get saved from? Like I tell you all the time, people think in church, as long as you don't drink, smoke, and cuss, you're a great Christian. Yeah, but all the womanizing, all the hatred, all the division, all the strife, all the racism in church, these things are not to be. We should love one another. Let me close with this. Dan covers me. I used to lose this stuff all the time, so now I give it to him so I don't lose it. My favorite Bible walked out of here, got my name on it, and I said, God, I'm not even mad. I hope they get saved reading it. It was Dr. Tim LaHaye's study Bible. And I went to buy a new one. They don't even make it no more. I said, I got to get online and find me one. But I want to close with this. We was created in His image and His likeness. Sin entered in and separated us from God. Now hang on here. Stick with me. Stick with me on this. The sin is what separated us. He didn't change who He made. Stick with this. I want y'all to listen to this. We were created in His image and His likeness. The fall of man, because Adam wouldn't do the right thing, sin separated us. You ain't getting this. I'm going to say it one more time. We was created in His image and His likeness. In His image and His likeness. Then sin separated us. So let me say it. Some of you didn't get it. Once we get forgiveness of our sin, then the natural thing of God's love and His likeness is still in us. It should come back to the top. And I know that we are Jesus' people because we're in His image and His likeness. Oh, some of y'all ain't getting this. It's a little bit over your head, maybe. I ain't trying to be arrogant there, but we, not our physical shapes, not our goofiness, none of that. I mean, our image. We as people was created to be Jesus' people. It's unnatural for us to serve the devil. So when you get saved and sell out and be patient, let God clean you up according to the potter's will in Jeremiah chapter 18, He'll get all the cleansing. I don't have to do that job. But you'll notice the more you search after Him, the more you run after Him, the more you seek for Him, the more you love Him, the more you worship Him, the more you pray to Him, you'll get a whole lot more like Him. Amen? Amen? Because see, Jesus set the standard for us. Oh, He was all God. But we was created in His image and His likeness. We're not God, but you know, we was created in His image and likeness. They should be able to see our brother's traits. Oh, y'all, you know that song, "We Are Family," you know. Now, of course, me and my brother, that's on a couple, we don't line up at all, do we? We different day and night. He's smart and I'm dumb. He's big, I'm little, and he's, anyway. Little in height. Little height. Somebody's laughing at me. No. If I was stretched out, I'd be pretty tall. But how many of you How many of you? How many of you are willing to say what John the Baptist said? I must decrease so he can increase. How many of us? I need to say it. That goes the hot dog guy again. They really messing me up walking by that window. I know what they got. Hot dog snake. Snake says, well, quit preaching. We can go get them. But that's what our prayer should be. God loves the little children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, we all precious in His sight. The first step in repentance is turning. Because if you're confessing, you got to be turning. Because you won't get it all out in the same position you was in. Listen to me. Then the second thing of true repentance is true forgiveness of yourself and others. And then the third thing, that to know you're His disciples by the amount of love that you show. It ain't always easy loving people. Just be real. It ain't. It just ain't. Especially if you was raised by a Marine and went in the Marine Corps, they teach you to hate everything. It's funny, they used to teach God, country, and court, and they teach you to destroy everything. Wow. Okay. Father, I thank you for allowing me to minister to your children. God, let this word take place in their garden and let it mature and grow. God, start in my life. Remove the things in my life that shouldn't be here, God. God, search my soul, my life with your eyesight. I trust your eyesight better than I trust my own eyesight to remove the things. And God, also help me, Lord, to attend my brother's garden. Help him. Let me help him, Lord, when he asks for it. Let me help him when he's hungry. Let me help him when he's naked, God. Let me help him when he's drifting away. Because, God, I may need that help. And I have had that help before, God. But God, teach us how to love one another the way Christ loves us. That way we'll fulfill the law. That they'll know we're your disciples. In the name of Jesus, amen and amen.